So what we've done so far, we've done customs brokers responsibilities. Those people who came in late, I hope everyone watched the lectures and went over the notes. We also went over the players, right? Who the players are, importer of record, the cosignee, nominal cosignee. We talked about difference between the legal repercussions. We talked about the difference between, for example, the agent and the importer, and whether that can be the same. We talked about foreign importer of record. Then we also talked about the record keeping. We know that there is a 5-year rule subject to certain exceptions, such as packing list, such as power of attorney, such as some entries which are done informally. We also talked about what else? We talked about the power of attorneys, right? We talked about that the power of attorney is required before you begin representation on behalf of someone else. We got stumbled upon a question of corporate entity needing a power of attorney, and I sent everyone an email where I went back to the regulatory history and found out that the provision that we stumbled upon last time was with respect to corporate entity and its employees, such as officers, such as secretary, CEO, CFO, who do not need power of attorney if they come in and do something on behalf of an entity. However, if that legal entity is a customs broker and it represents someone, let's say corporation customs broker represents corporation, not customs broker, the importer, then the power of attorney needed from the corporation importer to be given to the corporation customs broker. So think of them as a persons, right? They're legal persons who can have many people working, right? But think about them as one entity doing customs business. I think that will help. Sanya, did that clarify that? Because I got confused myself on this. So in parallel, we are moving on slowly but surely towards the subject of classification. So we went over the general notes, we went over the tariff tables, we went over elements of the tariff tables. We looked over what's legal and what's not legal, and we dove into the GRIs, the general rule of interpretation, and how we can use that framework to make sure that things are classified correctly. And this framework can be applied across the board. And we learn that it is written broadly, so that which means there is room for disagreement, but for the customs broker examination purposes, you will have less room to maneuver because you are given those 5 answer choices. You cannot go beyond that. So if you are constrained to the 5 answer choices and you also apply general rules of interpretation, you should be fine, okay? And we discussed general rule of interpretation 1, which talks about what's legally binding as far as classification. And we discussed 3 elements that one must refer to. One is the heading notes, those 4 digit notes on the classification. Then we also discussed about, we talked about the chapter notes, which are at the beginning of the chapter and they pertain to the whole chapter. And we also talked about the section notes. And the very first thing you need to do when you engage in classification process, go to the heading notes first, then go to the section notes. But don't go to the section notes if you are not dealing in different sections, if you are staying within one section, such as one chapter. So all your questions are in chapter 69, okay, or 85. Then section notes are not necessary. You go to the chapter notes, and you to read the chapter notes if you, the heading notes do not help you, okay? And we also, after we talked about, that's GRI 1, okay, general rule of interpretation 1. Then we went into the general rule of interpretation 2, where we came across the concept of essential character. essential character is kind of the eyeball rule. You look at something and you ask yourself, is that thing essentially what it is? Even though if it's incomplete, such as bicycle without the wheels, or if it's unassembled, okay? Such as bicycle with the wheels, but the wheels come alongside in the same box. And that's where we stopped. We stopped the general rule of interpretation 3. I know that I asked you to read over and do some homework questions with respect to the classification, which ask you to engage in an analysis which we haven't discussed. But there were also a lot of questions which were GRI-1 questions, which pretty much dealt with just navigating through the heading notes and the section and chapter notes of the HTS-US. We also talked about that when you get stuck, you would what is helpful to you when you get stuck is going to the table of contents. Alphabetical index. Thank you. Yes. So when you have no idea what that item is, for example, I had no idea what the girdle is, right? And you have no idea where to start. You go to the alphabetical index, and most likely, at least for the customs examination, it will suffice. It will head you to the right direction, and that will be the starting point for you to look at. So that's where we stopped. Anyone has any questions about the homework? Anyone has any questions about the new assignments that they want to go over with? Besides general rule of interpretation 3 through the remainder, 6 and ARIs, additional rules of interpretation, which we'll cover today. Any questions on... Yeah.
I don't know which question, I don't know which rules apply to the question I had a problem with, but like question 6.
Okay, just a moment. So homework question 6, tell me the class. Is it class 3? Class 2?
Oh, I'm sorry. Class 3.
Okay, class 3. And that was power of attorneys? Okay, just a moment. Okay, unfortunately I don't have the question with me, but if you wanna just read it out. Yeah, let me pull it out.
Okay.
So go ahead, start reading it. So what's
yeah. Okay. It says, what is the classification for a porcelain ceramic tile glazed and decorated with an elaborate floral design measuring 25 centimeters long by 25 centimeters wide by 1.5 centimeters high and designed for tiling a wall?
Okay. Okay. So, does everyone have that their questions with them? So let's. What I would do is I would open the HTS book. And may have a, yeah, because
yeah.
I don't have it in front of it. So. So essentially, what we have is. Is we have a porcelain ceramic tile. First of all, does everyone know what porcelain is and ceramic is? Porcelain and ceramic, well, it's used to be ceramic tile back in the day, which was made out of clay. Porcelain is an addition, I think it's a polymer addition, which is a plastic plastic compound, sorry? I mean, to start classifying, you kind of have to imagine yourself what you're doing in the beginning. So what I'm saying is before you start, Just picture yourself a tile. If you picture maybe your bathroom, okay, or someone's kitchen sometimes, right? It probably has a tile, okay? And that tile is probably ceramic, or if it's more recent, it's probably porcelain ceramic, okay? And how the tile is made? It is made out of the mixture of cement, clay, sometimes in the case of porcelain, it can be a polymer, right? But then it is mixed up, it is laid out, it is heated, it is glazed, and then it is sold at the store, okay? So immediately you think yourself of several things, okay? What is it made of, okay? It is made out of, okay, so you have polymer, so that's plastic, right? That's chapter 39. And then as you're going through this process, you should start thinking about the answer choices. So for A, we have, I'm just going to go with a heading right now, 6907. B, 6908. C, 6913. D, 6913. And E, 6914. Okay, so that's easy, because not everyone, the first two digits represent a chapter, right? So it's no brainer. You don't even think about if it's plastic or not plastic. You immediately know that the question deals with classification of chapter 69, harmonized tariff schedule. So what we do is we go to the chapter 69. So let me open up. I hope everyone can see, because I can get the correction to the certain limit, but I'm limited by the framework of this room. I wish I had the pull down board. So let's go to chapter 69 and immediately note ceramic products. Okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, that's easy. So open it up. And so first thing we have is now we deal with this 07, 08, 13 and 14. Okay, so that's one, that's two, that's three. That's four. So when I look at this, I know that those are the headings that I'm dealing with. So first thing I do is I have no clue what those headings are, but I want to check them out without even going further. I know we have 10 digits, okay? But I'm not going to go any further until I establish which heading is applicable. So I just go to the first one without any further knowledge. 6907, I'm sorry. Okay, so 6907, right there, says unglazed ceramic flags and paving. But wait a minute, it says it's glazed, right? So that's it, that was it, I can cross it out. If it's unglazed here, unglazed ceramic cubes, not on bank. So this deals with the tile which is not glazed. And glaze is this shiny stuff that is covering the tile. So, okay. So now I crossed out this. So now I have to figure out if those headings are applicable. So I go to 6908. Okay. So 6908, let's bless you. 6908 says glazed ceramic flags pavings or wall tiles. Notice glazed wall tiles, the keywords. Okay, so that's good. So 6908 seems like a choice. Okay, Let me go just to double check whether 6913 is applicable. Okay, let's see, 6913 deals with what? Statuettes and other ornamental articles. You know, I have seen mosaic glaze style, okay? If you go to some subways, okay? If you go to, I think, some I think it was City Borough City Hall, or if you go to the Transit Museum, which I highly recommend. If anyone hasn't been to the Transit Museum in Brooklyn, it's the only subway under subway museum underneath. At least that's what they proclaim. You will see a lot of mosaic tile. Okay, that's ornamental. The problem is here is you're not told. Oh, and decorate with love. Oh. Okay, wait a minute. You're told that it's decorated with elaborate floral design. Okay, so 6913 is a possibility. Okay, because it can be regarded as ornamental. Okay, so do you see where I'm going?
No, but I see that too. I remember that because of the size, so it's no good. It's more than certain cm.
Well, before you go to the size, okay?
I know.
Before you go to the size, you first must go to establish the heading. And all the heading doesn't talk about the size,
no.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, the heading only talks about statues and other ornamental articles, okay? So I know that this is a candidate because it says it has elaborate floral design, all right? So, now, let's go to 64. So now I have those two headings, which are candidates. Now I go to 6914. Other ceramic articles? No. Because I have more specific description. Okay. Now note, at this point, by the way, I do not know what the answer is for this one. Don't tell me, please. At this point, I know that I have to dig in further because I do not have any other information, okay? So normally what I would do here, because if it's ornamental, it should be 6913, okay? So, and 6913, let me get what I would do here. I know usually I told you to GRI1, now you should check the section notes and the chapter notes, okay? Since I'm here, I would probably check. The section and chapter notes probably have the answer for this one. But I would just real briefly check. So I have 6913, 10, 5, 0. It looks like I'm using a newer version of the HTS-US. Okay. So I'm using the 2013 version. This is 2014. So let's see, what can it be?
Maybe if you scroll up.
No. Oh, wait a minute. I'm sorry. 60. Yes. Yes, you're right. 6914. 1050. Okay. So I'm quickly looking at the. I know the price over $2.5 each don't fit, okay, because I have no information about the price. And I have of porcelain China other, okay, so it's a possibility. The C is a possibility, okay, and 90, which is here, 9020 of ceramic tile, maybe. Okay, so this way I need to go to the section to the chapter notes, because I'm not going to the section notes because I'm not dealing with the different sections. So I go to the chapter notes, which is way at the very beginning. Let me see, and see if they have any clues. Okay, so I take a look and I say this chapter applies only to ceramic products that have been fired after shaping. It doesn't cover, well, I know it does cover, so to me it's not helpful. What's not covered, I know that it is one of those, it is within the chapter. So the section note 2, this whole section which it doesn't cover, I just skip it. Additional US notes, okay, let's see. So look at note 3, okay, the term tiles. So I have a ceramic tile, okay, and it says the term tile does not include any article 3.5 centimeters or more in thickness, 3.2 centimeters, okay. So I have 1.5 centimeter high, 25 centimeters wide. So I have a length 25, 25, and 1.5. Okay, 1.5, I think it's what it is the thickness. So you have the ceramic tile. Okay, it's a bad drawing, but let's say it's a tile. Okay, so it's 25, 25, and this distance is 1.5. Notice 6905, 6907, 6908, which is ours, does not include any tiles 3.2 centimeters or more in thickness, but this is applicable to me, right? So for my purposes, it's or more in thickness is actually less than 3.2. So I cannot exclude B on this information. Okay, so let's go down. 69, so next one says 69 14. Okay, so I'm dealing with 69 13, so this may potentially be applicable. Okay, so let's see what it says. Okay, I don't see anything helpful here. Okay, I just see some definitions. Okay, and it talks about the porcelain. It talks about the technical stuff. I do not have information about technical, I just have the names. Porcelain, okay? If customs examiners say it's a porcelain, I presume it is porcelain as used here. So I'm not looking at the details, okay? So this five, note 5, is not helpful. I don't see anything that can help me here because it deals with technicalities. Now, I'm still stuck between 08 and 13. Mm-hmm. So the next note, which is 69.11, 69.12, is not very helpful either because it doesn't deal with either. Okay, the next one. It says, for the purposes of heading 69.13, those provisions which classify measures according to the value and according to the single tariff may consist of more than one piece. Okay. To me, no value is given.
Right.
Now note, value is a component. You must know value before you place it here. Right, 2.5. Do they give you this information?
No.
So is that a hint by customs examiners that these things are probably not applicable? Okay. Because remember we talked about the single best transfer rule.
Right.
Right. On the facts provided, you cannot figure out if this applies, because you. Maybe this, what is it, $2.5 or cents or whatever. Maybe it's so, the floral design is so elaborative, right? done by the best Chinese artist, right? That is probably $100, okay, per piece. Can it be? It's possible. We don't know, okay? Are we to presume that? No. But I'm just saying that you cannot figure it out based on information provided. So that's it. I went through the notes, and I know that the value is a component in, let me see, in 6913. Okay, so 6913, the first one, 6913, 10, let's see, 1050. I cannot classify it here unless I know that this is, by the way, this is something which we'll be discussing later on because we're dealing with GRI6 now, okay? But it's okay. It's a good introduction, okay? You do not know if it's over 250 dH. Are you allowed to presume? No, you can't, okay? And if customs examiners didn't tell you that, then you cannot rule, you cannot say that this is the correct one. So what I would do, again, I haven't seen the answer, right? If customs examiner picks this one, I mean, I think I can reason through it by using the GRI 3C analysis. But I would rule this one out, see, because I do not know what the value is, okay? The next one, ninety twenty, is also 250. I do not know that either. So what's left? B. Is B the correct answer?
Yeah, it's the correct answer.
Okay, phew, thank God. This is the methodology that I would use.
It worked. The thing where they tricked us was in the chapter notes where it says not over a height of 3.2.
Okay, let's go back to the chapter. But before I go in there, does everyone see the value, right? Does everyone see that the value is really the key? You cannot presume, you cannot make assumptions if they don't give you enough information, with certain exceptions. We discussed one in the case of APTA, I think, in the free trade agreement. With certain exceptions, okay, it's very rare that if they throw you a bunch of information but they forget to include something, it's for the reason. Had they told you the price, had they told you it's $100 per each piece, you know what? I would cross this one out. Because there is a reason why they tell you the value.
Okay.
So details are the key. Now let's go back to the section notes. I'm sorry, chapter notes. So let's see. I think it was US note, right? Okay, right there. So for the purposes of heading, in our case 6908, the term tiles does not include any article of 3.5 centimeters or more in thickness. Ours is 1.5 centimeters.
But if you use length times width times height as your formula, you would think the width was 25 centimeters.
No. Okay, so let's picture what we're dealing with here, okay? So you're saying you have a length, which is 25 centimeters. Then you have a width, okay? Which is 25, okay? And then we have what? Height, right? Which is 1.5, okay? This. Thickness. Width, height. So we have a length. Length 25. We have a width 25. And then we have a height 25. Other additional US notes talk about thickness. or they talk about length, width, and height. So when the crafters, the drafters of the additional ES node said thickness, they did it on purpose.
Right.
Because if they would say height,
we would know.
I can say height. If I flip this over, then the height would be 25. Okay? But this way, either way I do it, thickness to any average person would mean the thickness which is something you hold and which is the, has the shortest length.
Right.
Okay? So this is the reason they use the word thickness. All right? So this, when you deal with the terminology, don't get tricked by that terms. All right? So does it make sense to everyone how we think this through? As you practice, you will get better in this. The trick is to just do it. And hopefully the explanations and the ones that I write out and the ones that I talk about are...
too many time to find out the right answer more than
Well, no, it's actually more time for me to talk it out, but whenever you flip this through, you actually have those thoughts with a blink of an eye, right? You're not thinking, well, is this or is that, or you do not draw this out, okay? You just say length with height, 1.5, 3.5, 1.5 less than 3.5, boom, that's not applicable. And once you do that, the second time this type of question comes around, because a lot of those questions do tend to repeat themselves, you'll know. Okay?
Can you get into the question 8, please?
Yes.
Do you want to hear the question?
No, I'll just use his.
Okay. I picked the A, but...
Question 8?
8.
Okay, question 8.
8.
All right. Another question dealing with, I think, with something which I was hoping to cover last class, but I didn't. But I think it's a good introduction. So let's do it. Oops. Okay. Question 8 says, your client is importing Will Grow, a product described as a natural fertilizer that is manufactured from mustard seed meal. The fertilizer is suitable for fruits, vegetables, and turf. Will Grow is a dry granule product imported from Costa Rica in 5 kilogram packages. What is the tariff classification of the product? Okay, so Will Grow. What is Will Grow? It's a fertilizer. Okay, so that's a key thing. Fertilizer. So you're actually dealing, note that you're dealing with a use provision. You're not dealing with a type. Okay, you're dealing with a use. What's a usable product? To fertilize whatever it is. Maybe, in this case, they tell us it's to fertilize food products, fruits, vegetables, and also fertilize the turf on which presumably those fruits and vegetables grow. Okay, so this is the background, okay? Now, as with the previous one, I focus on the heading first. A, B, C, D, E. Okay, so I have a choice. I have heading 3101, 3102, 3105, 3824. So I have 3 in chapter 31, 1, so that's 1 chapter. First, I must figure out which chapter I'm using. That's number 1. That's number 2. And then I have not applicable. So none of this applies. So that's actually easier for me because now I'm only dealing with with four items. And really I'm dealing with two chapters, okay? So what I do is I go to HTS-US. I open up, I'm looking at the chapter 31, which says fertilizers. Fertilizers, okay? What's chapter 38? Miscellaneous. I have a fertilizer versus miscellaneous. Chapter 38 says miscellaneous chemical products. I know it's hard to see. Chapter 38. And chapter 31, fertilizers. Well, this is, I think everyone will agree that it's safe to cross this one out. Okay? So I'm down to chapter 31. Is it 31 or it is not 31? So what I do is I open up the book and I look at the heading first. I'm not even looking at the chapter notes at this point. So I have 3101, which says animal or vegetable fertilizers. It's a natural fertilizer. If it's natural, it can be an animal or vegetable. So it's a possibility, right? Let's look at 3102. Oh, but mixing chemical treatment. Well, I don't have any of that. I don't have information. But I know if it's animal or vegetable, it's probably natural. Whenever you see this, I know the term natural is not defined. I think organic is defined nowadays, USDA, but to use common sense, if it's natural, it's something which is not synthetic or produced in a laboratory. Okay, this is not in a laboratory. Unless those are animal vegetables animal vegetables in a laboratory, which is not possible nowadays, but that's third degree imagination. This should not be that complicated. So if you see animal or vegetable fertilizer, natural, okay. Check mark. Do not exclude it yet. 3102. Mineral and chemical fertilizers. Okay. Mineral, chemical. So, is mineral, I know chemical is not natural, right? But is mineral a natural? Possibly. Mineral is a naturally occurring product, right? So, I do not exclude that. And then I have 3105, and I just read the heading, and 3905 says mineral, okay, fertilizers containing two or three of fertilizing elements, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. I am told, customs examiners tell me that this is manufactured from mustard seed meal. Mustard seed meal. Okay. Nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. I must have two or three of those elements. Do customs examiners tell me that those elements exist? No. They just told me about mustard seed meal, which is vegetable product. In fact, so now I can cross this one out.
That is the answer.
That's the answer.
Yeah, that is why I picked the A. I picked answer A. But you know that is.
I picked E, none of the above. Yeah, not when I saw the.
Basically, because of the name.
I always pick this
one. That's what I picked, none of the above.
Yeah. Hold on a second. Hold on a second. Mineral came out. Okay. So this was would probably be the one which I would get wrong. So this is
the packing is according to the
No. Here is what here. No. So take a look. It It's not careful reading on my part. Mineral chemical fertilizer contain two or three of the fertilizing element, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Do they have them? We are told that it's mustard seed meal. No. They don't have that. We have mustard seed meal. Whenever you have a semicolon, this is a semicolon right here. I think I can write it. No, I cannot write on that. So a semicolon right here. Let me increase it. Can everyone see that? Semicolon? Yeah. I think a hand tool. Here. This means this is part one. This is part two. It not re- does not have to be related. Understand? Goods of this chapter in tablets or similar forms or in packages of a gross weight not exceeding 10 kilograms. Goods of this chapter. We talked about the goods of this chapter, and previously we talked about the 3101. This is a good of this chapter, right?
Yes.
This is of this chapter, and this is possibly of this chapter. The only problem is I'm not sure if mustard seed meal can be regarded as a mineral because it's vegetable. Most likely, it is this good. If it's imported in bulk, like on one of those big ships where those piles of grain and other bulk materials are, this is the classification you use. But if it's imported, packaged, then you use this one. Okay. Huh. See how can I bend the fact? I have
a question.
Yes.
Because the second part of the sentence, other fertilizers, goods of this chapter, and tablets are similar forms, it supersedes the first sentence?
No. Those are totally separate sentences. So this is one, and this is two. Independent of each other.
They are?
Yes.
Oh.
Wow.
Independent of each other.
It got me right there.
It got me? You got me. Did I say something?
Yeah, you break down the
question 8. Let me see what I write.
Yeah, you give the answer, but I still think the answer A is correct, but now I got the picture.
Okay, you guys wanna finish this one? Mineral, okay, so we have, assuming that this is right, now we cannot cross this out. So, but we can cross this out, because we're now being told it's 5 kilograms, which does not exceed 10 kilograms. Now we compare 3102 to 3105. 3102 is mineral. Again, nothing about weight. So you cross this out and you're only left with this one.
If they did not talk about the weight, the possible answer would be A2, right?
Yes, but customs examiners still hint you. Remember, like they tell you it's beautiful, it's highly decorated ceramic tile, but they never told you the value. And the only way you could know the value, you could put it there in that classification, is if you knew it was $2.5 or more dollars, okay?
So every time there's a number that's...
They hint you, and this is why they use a single best answer rule.
Let me specify. If the package on the question, say 50 kilos, then the answer would be the A then. Is that correct?
If the package says 50 kilos, the answer would be A, yes. I would do that.
So, I mean,
A. A.
A.
10 kilograms. I mean 50 kilograms. It's a vegetable. The again, you can challenge me on this one, but mustard seed is a vegetable food.
It doesn't describe the weight. So A is also the right answer, right?
It will, yes, and we'll talk about the GRI-3A. It says whichever is more specific is the one that should be picked. And this is more specific. But if you are given weight, it's an objective criteria for you to exclude that one. Very good stuff. Yeah, and again, I go through so many of them. Sometimes I'm wrong myself. And this is one of those type of exams where you do not have to be perfect. You just have to be 75% good or more. All right.
Question five.
Let's do it. You want to give it to me? Here. I'm just taking yours because I assume you know what the question is, and everyone else can be on the same page with me. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Question 5. Question 5. What is the classification of disposable plastic sleeve protectors constructed of 100% PVC, polyvinyl, PVC plastic from China? Okay, well, first of all, if it's from China or not from China, it doesn't matter, right? We're dealing with strictly classification. So as we always do, we have a sleeve protector. What is sleeve protector? It's the stuff, I don't know if many of you watch those chemical or hazardous, maybe in hospital settings, you have those things. Or in the meat industry, right? You have butchers, they wear these big sleeves, and they have all bloody and stuff. So it is applied in many settings. Mm-hmm. Why am I talking about this? Because oftentimes you will find harmonized tariff schedule saying something like medical equipment, okay, or equipment for surgical settings. And I believe chapter 39 has that, but let's look at the answer choices. So we have disposable plastic